Hello and welcome to video lecture series in Sociology. Today we are going to discuss chapter 8 titled as Social Movements from your textbook Social Change and Development in India. For understanding, we have divided this chapter into 6 parts. So far we have discussed about the definition and features of a social movement. We have discussed that how social movements have been decisive in bringing about change in society. We have also discussed about various types of movements, social movements, particularly new and old social movements, and about civil society. Today we are going to discuss about various theories of social movements. Now, as you know, social movements have become widespread in modern societies. With modernity and change, now people are bound less by traditions and customs or norms and law in society. Cultural and countercultural movements or conflict of interest of different groups of people is an inevitable feature of modern industrial societies. According to famous sociologist Sidney Taro, there are times when social movements are rare, that is, they are not occurring, and there are times when many social movements emerge to promote social change in society. Taro calls these as waves of protest or the social movements. During the colonial rule, in the nationalist movement, people from different sections of society united against the British and fought for freedom. Nationalist movement was able to unite people from different caste, class, religion and community background. But the same people from different class category or backgrounds after independence represented different and opposing interests pertaining to their language, caste, community, class or subgroup. Now, social movements emerge as an organized response of the excluded or exploited groups against the social, political and economic conditions. The masses may not necessarily demand sharing of power, but they at least desire for a fair and satisfactory solution of their problems, or at least being represented. Various sociologists have come up with a range of explanations attempting to understand pattern, nature, causes and consequences of social movements. Let us understand these as social theories of social movement. In this section, we will discuss some of the relevant and significant theories explaining the nature of social movements. Let us begin with this. Now, Denton Morrison proposed relative deprivation theory of social movements. This is a general theory attempting to explain why individuals join a social movement. A person experiences a situation of deprivation when he compares his situation or circumstances with others in society. This relative deprivation means that the person feels that he is not receiving fair share of the available resources. Thus, when the group or an individual feels that they are worse off as compared to others around them, the social conflict arises. The theory emphasizes the role of psychological factors such as resentment, rage, and anger in inciting social conflict and subsequent social movements. Let us discuss more about what are these psychological factors. One of the main ideas of relative deprivation is related to the idea of expectations. This implies that what do people think and believe they deserve and want in life? That is, these are expectations. If these expectations are met, they are satisfied and do not experience discontent or relative deprivation. But if they compare themselves to other people or groups and find that they have less, they experience the situation of relative deprivation and dissatisfaction or consequent frustration. When an individual feels that the others with whom he compares himself has better opportunities, access to resources, or anything else for that matter, he will experience this deprivation. Related to the idea of expectation is the second important notion of legitimate expectations. Now, what are legitimate expectations? Relative deprivation is not a simple idea or experience that I do not have what others have and that people want what everyone else has. The idea of legitimate expectation means that individuals think that they deserve something and have a right to have it, the legitimate right to have it. Therefore, they think that something should be done to find a solution to the problem if they do not get what they think they deserve legitimately. These expectations are not simple desires, but they are perceived to be legitimate as rightful expectations. Apart from expectations and legitimate expectations, the third important notion is of blocked expectations. What do we mean by blocked expectations? This means that when an individual or individuals are unable to achieve goals through conventional means, a feeling of relative deprivation arises. If expectations that are perceived as legitimate are met, there is a sense of satisfaction among people. If expectations are not achieved, they experience discontent and frustration. But if the expectations are perceived as legitimate and there is a block in achieving these expectations, the resultant anger and frustration is all the more greater among these people. In such situations of anger or discontent, people are more likely to take an action to change the situation and the circumstances they are prevailing in. Their collective action may take shape of a social movement, say a social movement against corruption. According to Morrison, certain structural conditions also increase the likelihood or probability of emergence of a social movement. Now, what are these conditions? These conditions are like when a large number of people experience a similar kind of situation of relative deprivation, or all of them are victim of the same situation, or say corruption. Secondly, when people or groups experiencing relative deprivation interact and communicate with each other quite often, openly, and they share their grievances, that is, they come to know that all of us are experiencing this similar situation. Next, it is also easier to come together and start a movement if the group experiencing relative deprivation are more or less socially homogeneous in nature, that is, from a similar cultural, class or economic background. The diversity or heterogeneity of group can possibly make a social movement weak, as people from different backgrounds will be driven by diverse goals and different set of interests. The next point may be the likelihood of emergence of social movements is more in rigidly stratified society, because every action has an equal and opposite reaction. In such societies, differences between the groups of haves and have-nots are clear-cut and obvious. There is a strict hierarchy and gap that differentiates the two. Moreover, the inflexibility of structure does not give scope or avenues for mobility to these people. Thus, their reaction is great whenever it comes into existence. Thus, in the absence of these chances, the reaction is greater as compared to situations which are flexible or permit some degree of social mobility. The presence of civil society and appropriate social institution also helps in supporting social movements. The institutional structure in a society gives a sense that an association or collective action can make a difference and bring desirable changes, as desired by the people. Moreover, good organizational and leadership skills are also necessary to make a social movement effective and successful. However, this theory has its limitations. All the instances where people feel relatively deprived do not result in social movements. Say, while perceptions of deprivation may be a necessary condition for collective action, they are not a sufficient reason in themselves, because there is no direct causal relationship between relative deprivation and collective action. Based on the notion of the rational utility maximizing individual, Olson argues that social movement is an aggregation of rational individual actors pursuing a common goal driven by their self-interest. A person will join a social movement only if he tends to gain something from being part of it, and he will participate only if the risks taken are less as compared to the gains from the social movement. Rather than the factors motivating people to join social movements, the resource mobilization theory focuses upon the social and structural factors affecting movement's success or failure, or the outcome of a social movement. According to Oberschill, the theory of relative deprivation cannot explain social movements completely, as there is no society that satisfy or can satisfy all of its citizens equally. No society is perfect. Discontent is a common feature of all modern societies. Some or the other group in a heterogeneous society will always have one or the other reason for dissatisfaction or anger. The key factor in success or failure of a social movement is its capacity to mobilize and manage available resources efficiently. What are these resources? These resources include volunteers or participants, their time, money, contacts, alliances of these participants with other people, say with media, media access, networking, computers, general equipment that is required to run a social movement, paid staff that helps as a secretarial service, office space to run organizational activities, and many such things. These resources are acquired and managed by social movement organizations, which are also called as SMO. The success of social movement is largely dependent upon the efficient use of available resources and ability to garner more and use them appropriately according to the desire. Social movements cannot succeed without help from the participants and outsiders. There are various categories of people who can be mobilized for a social movement. In order to be successful, movements must mobilize and use resources to turn outsiders and the bystanding public as part of the movement and must be able to neutralize the action of the opponents. For example, in a social movement, people might carry out march. They hold demonstration or dharna that will be covered by media. But this coverage and the entire activity requires organization to coordinate transportation, managing people or public address system, printing and distribution of leaflets and pamphlets. So, all these activities of organizing, the activities of a social movement require coordinated efforts of people to ensure that nothing goes wrong that might damage or go against the image of the core ideas of the social movement. Thus, a movement is likely to be more effective if it can collect and effectively manage the available resources within the given political and institutional structure, such as leadership, organizational capacity, and communication facilities available to them. However, critics argue that success of social movement is not limited by existing resources. It can create resources such as new symbols and identities in the process of the movement itself. A number of movements by people belonging to poor sections of society have been successful, and it proves that scarcity of resources need not be a constraint in becoming a movement successful. Even if initially they begin with limited material resources and organizational base, a movement can generate additional resources during the process of the struggle itself. Political process theory of social movement focuses upon macro sociological issues that make social movements possible. According to MacAdam, economic and especially political factors are central to the emergence of social movements. What are these factors? These factors are, number one, organizational strength, that is the cohesiveness of the group. The second point is cognitive liberation, that is belief in the success of the attempt that an individual or group of people make. Third is political opportunities, that is the ability to make mainstream political groups as partners or allies in the social movement. According to MacAdam, availability of these three factors is related to the nature of the political system in general of any given society. At times, political connections are more important than the availability of material resources, and political leverage is the main resource for the success of a social movement. Thus, we can say that emergence and success of social movements is dependent upon a large number of actors and factors. In social movements, people engage in unconventional behavior that challenges the established social norms and expectations. This participation is influenced by the interest of the individual as well as behavior of the others and ability of the movement to mobilize participants. These movements are a source of mitigating pressures and anxiety. At the same time, they are forces bringing about desirable change in the society, community, or organizations. Unlike collective behavior, which is unorganized, not planned, short-lived, maybe spontaneous, social movements are organized, planned, and they run over a long period of time. Think of various examples of social movements from the present and past, from your own society or from other parts of the world, and try to see which theory of social movement explains best these kind of examples. Let us summarize what we discussed in this lecture. In this particular lecture class, we discussed about the different theories of social movements and their criticisms. These theories were the theory of relative deprivation, resource mobilization theory, and political process theories. These theories indicate that why social movements occur, how and why they become successful, and what are the institutional and structural conditions that are necessary for a social movement to emerge and also to become successful. In next part of this chapter, we'll discuss about stages in a social movement and a variety of examples to explain various types of social movements. Till then, you can enjoy reading this part of the chapter. Thank you.